Erev Tov Chavrim, I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live. Very, very interesting things happening around the world today. And of course, Sabre strike, NATO rushes thousands of troops, including air defense systems, Poland's in the Baltic states to boost readiness on its eastern flank there. That's a report here being brought out by our good friend Lorenzo there on Already Happened there. These troops, of course, have crossed from Germany into the Czech Republic. We're going to be trying to catch up with the convoy ourselves here in the Czech Republic, try to bring you up to date of this particular exercise, in particularly because Israeli forces are going to be involved in this particular military drills that is happening this month here in June, all the way to the 15th of June in Eastern Europe, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, etc. Massive amount of military forces going to Russia's front there, unprecedented since probably World War II. Have we seen that much forces there headed to the border there? Also, Haaretz is reporting in the first Israel participants in major NATO exercise near Russia. Of course, the 18,000 soldiers from 19 countries are participating. The Haaretz is speaking about in the Sabre strike. 18 drill NATO's eastern flank on Russia's military maneuvers are increasingly worrying nearby NATO members, as they stress, which that happens to be a photo from Haaretz from Russia's particular drills that they hold with Belarus inside of Belarus country. And mainly Russia has been holding larger and larger drills because it's got a landlocked province there just on the other side of Lithuania. Belarus and, of course, Lithuania, Latvia kind of keeps it landlocked. That's Kaliningrad that we're speaking about, Poland on its southern border. And so that leaves Russians kind of at the mercy of Europe in the event a war ever did kick off. So a lot of tensions going on there. And this much larger drill is very worrisome as well. And it's kind of strange, given the latest conversations that have been coming out of Syria with Russia and Israel cooperating a bit. Going to get into that in just a moment here. First, I want to go to the article from Lorenzo on his particular webpage, already-happened.com. Sabre strike, NATO rushes thousands of troops, including air defense systems, to Poland and the Baltic states to boost readiness on its eastern flank there. And he says here that the maneuvers will run through June 15th and come as Poland has indicated it is considering a proposal to host a permanent contingent of U.S. troops in the way that Germany and Italy have done since World War II. Now, that's something that Russia has vowed to retaliate for if that does happen. Now, when I say retaliate, I have a feeling that Russia may take up and put a base inside of Europe in one of its own countries that is closer to them. Just have to wait to see how that actually goes. Not looking very good, to say the very least there. Newsweek also speaking, U.S. military will leave Syria base and deal with Russia. As a report coming out right now, Al-Tanf, the very military facility that Israeli News Live put on the map back, gosh, I don't even know how long ago that was. We were really looking at Al-Tanf there. The mainstream media had not been reporting about Al-Tanf, and we really helped put that on the map. And now the U.S. is talking about giving up that particular military spot, working with Russia on the reports. This is coming out from by Tom O'Connor on Newsweek. States here, the report, which first surfaced Sunday in Saudi Arabian newspaper Ashaq al-Aswad, came as Russian Deputy Foreign Minister Mikhail Bogdanov said Tuesday that Moscow supported the idea of holding trilateral meeting at a level convenient for our partners, according to the state-run RIA Novosti. The U.S. and the Middle Eastern ally Jordan are opponents of Syrian President Bashar al-Assad, whose forces, backed by Russia and Iran, are planning a new offensive against the rebels and jihad across southern Syria. Now, that kind of makes it interesting as well, because there's been a lot of talk about... let me see if I can find it real quick. Oh, goodness. Thought I had it on here. Give me one second here. There's been a lot of talk Well, I'll just bring it out. I'll bring it out. We'll go back to this in just a moment there. About Israel and Russia, and that Israel and Russia, in the meeting that they had with Shoigu, the defense minister there, Defense Minister Lieberman of Israel, that it has been said publicly that Russia has given a green light to Israel to strike Iranian targets. Well, you know, that just doesn't seem normal from what I've been able to gather on all of this. And in fact, we had just seen come out on RT the interview with Murad Ghazdiyev and President Bashar al-Assad, and it had a completely different picture being painted. And it looks like President Assad is definitely going to be staying in power. And of course, he also has said that he invited the Iranians to his country, and that it wasn't actually Iranian forces, but it's Iranian officers, multiple officers that are in his country to help him with his own forces and with militants that are fighting inside of the country. Now, I actually reached out to Murad Ghazdiyev because we have been in correspondence with him now for a couple of years, and requested his own insights on the issue that was being presented, that Israel had been given a green light in order to be able to take out Iranian forces. And his response back was, there's a lot of fake news going around right now. But he wasn't sure if there was any such negotiations actually given that type of green light, but lean more towards the idea of fake news. Well, I can kind of believe that as well, but I'm also cautiously watching because, as you guys know, we have been looking at that Silk Road, the new initiative, a new world order that is being framed up right now. And I think the latest move here, North Korea says Kim Jong Un will meet with Syria's Assad. That is a new shocker and a pretty much slap in the face to President Trump as he's over there trying to wine and dine North Korea's President Kim Jong Un in order to bring about a peace resolution that would also make President Trump look good. As they say, Kim Jong Un keeps trying to meet with all those that are against the United States, or at least in the case of the war in the Middle East there. But I don't think that's really the case. Says here, President Bashar al-Assad of Syria plans to visit North Korea's leader Kim Jong Un, the North's state-run news media said on Sunday, suggesting that Mr. Kim is continuing his outreach to American adversaries even as he courts President Trump. The report, which was not confirmed by Syria, came just days after Mr. Trump announced that the previously canceled summit between the American and President Mr. Kim in Singapore was back on for June 12th. If Mr. Assad were to visit Pyongyang, it would be the first time that Mr. Kim hosted a meeting with another head of state in North Korean capital. All right, now this actually came after, as you can see in the picture right here, this is the ambassador for North Korea, Mr. Moon Jong-nam, on Wednesday actually delivered to President Assad, he is the new ambassador to Damascus, the invitation from Kim Jong-un. I think this has everything to do with the Silk Road, because after all, why else would Kim Jong-un be so willingly talking about giving up his nukes the way he is and meeting with the United States? I think this meeting with President Xi Jinping of China really helped put North Korea on a map of becoming one of the major trade partners of such a small nation in the Silk Road Initiative. And that, I think, is what has changed this young man's opinion altogether. And of course, getting an ambassador inside of Syria and working with President Bashar al-Assad, where there's going to be a major reconstruction effort, is also paving a way for North Korea to build its own economy. That's something that I'm watching. Speaking of that, I've got a good friend of mine. I can't speak about who his name is, but that brother no doubt will be watching. He is, I don't even want to say what he is in China, but he's a very good friend of mine, and we do love him, pray for him. He's in contact with many, many Christians in China. That's one reason why we still actively need to get someone to please help us to transcribe these messages, especially the prophetic insights here on Israeli News Live, because they have made it a way for our Chinese Christian friends to be able to hear the prophetic insights on Israeli News Live. We just need a transcriber. So, hey, if you, or even if you speak Chinese and you're willing to translate in the Mandarin language there, anything like that would be a blessing. He sent me this video here, and it's very interesting because this is China's video here about the upcoming SCO conference, third one being held in China in a different city though this time. And of course, it's about these huge block of eight nations that are becoming a major economic powerhouse. It was in Shanghai before, Beijing, and now they're doing it in Guangzhou, is where the summit will be held this time. And of course, China being the big mover of the One Belt, One Road, Silk Road initiative, hosting now 20% of the global GDP in this conference here, is going to weigh heavily on what's going on. And of course, we get a lot of these. You can easily subscribe as well to the New China Xinhua video on YouTube there to see a lot of this that comes out. By the way, let me just pause that real quick. That's China, Kazakhstan, Russia, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, India, and Pakistan. These are the countries that are involved right now. And of course, the summit will also be speaking about building the Silk Road through those countries. And I have a feeling, we already know that China has met with Iran. Doesn't mean that they're part of the SCO as of yet, but I'm sure Iran, Syria, Israel, all those nations will be joining in because they've all been working with China for this major move and what is happening in what I call a New World Order initiative. Very troubling. Qatar may soon also buy the Russia's S-400 anti-aircraft system, according to the ambassador there. This coming out on different news, RT reporting about this. And I can see why Qatar is interested, because there is always a little bit of rift between them and Saudi Arabia, and especially after the Qatarians have seen just exactly what the Saudis were willing to do. They're willing to throw them under the bus if necessary, and they don't want to end up like Yemen. Of course, Qatar being a much smaller nation wouldn't go very well for them. Never-ending conflict, Russia and Israel now plotting against Iran. That was the article I was actually looking for. And again, my good friend there over at RT states that, you know, again, he's not saying that it is fake news, but he said there's just a lot of fake news going on around the world right now. So very good possibility that that's exactly what we're dealing with. And so at any rate there, Moscow updates the playbook on making Israel and Iran happy. That's another article about this, the Al-Monitor bringing out on this article here. This seems to be a little bit more balanced about what's happening in there. Israeli Defense Minister Avigdor Lieberman and the top Israeli officials met May 31st. The Russian Defense Minister Sergei Shoigu, the primary focus was the visit was the situation in Syria, specifically in Lieberman's words, the entrenchment of Iran and its proxies there. By the way, that kind of lets you know too, even though Israel is always saying that Iran has to get its troops out of the country, proxies is what it looks like. That's another issue I kind of reached out to a friend of mine there and asked about to see if that's so. And again, he's met with the man that claims that no, it's Iranian military officers working inside of his country. And in fact, even went further to say that the ones that are being killed over there when Israel has been striking, yes, it's been Iranian officers, but it's also been Syrian troops that have been working alongside with them, not to mention the militants. Now, these militants are the proxies, Iranian proxies that are fighting there. What nationalities are they? Or are they tribal men? I'm not really sure how that works out. Could be similar to Russia's Wagner group. Don't know the answer to that, but that's kind of where everything has fallen as of right now. Also, my good friend over in the Netherlands sent me this article here from Breitbart News. French President Emmanuel Macron has declared he will govern France like Jupiter, the Roman king of gods, shortly after officials told the media his thought process was too complex for journalists to understand, summoning over 900 politicians from both houses of the French Parliament to a rare congress at a palace of Louis XIV, the Sun King, in Versailles. He threatened to overrule lawmakers with a referendum if they tried to frustrate the reforms he wishes to impose on legislature. Such assemblies are usually reserved for times of national crisis. Reuters reports him as saying he desires to reign as Jupiterian president, a remote, dignified figure like the Roman god of gods who weighs his rare pronouncements carefully. Boy, isn't that, I guarantee you that will scream around the world that Macron is the Antichrist. I don't say that myself, but we are living in some rather strange times. Anyway, we appreciate your support of this broadcast. Please remember us if you would. IsraeliNewsLive.org. You can give there. Also, Patreon.com/IsraeliNewsLive. Check out the channel over there. We're putting out videos there that we don't always put out here because of the content. And I will be recording again there tomorrow. I'm Stephen Benoon with Israeli News Live. Also listen to Hebrew Nation Radio. We also air there on Flashpoint with Bonnie Harvey. Supposed to be already recording that as of now, but I miss Bonnie and Bonnie's missing me. So I was actually going to try to bring Bonnie here with us tonight live, but it's all right. Shalom, shalom in a world of Ain Shalom. Stephen Benoon. Special report coming tomorrow night. I think we're going to pre-record this particular interview. Not going to talk too much about it right now, but it's going to be very sensitive. But we need to bring out some issues there. And we have a special guest coming on tomorrow night that I think will be an eye-opener for many of you. I'm Stephen Benoon with Israeli News Live, Erev Tov.